Woe to the teachers of the law, the day of the saints is here. Woe to the
Welcome to God News Network, where the saints are rising, where we are here to fulfill the word of God. The mystery which has been hidden from ages and from generations, but now has been revealed to his saints. Are you a saint? How do you find out? By listening to God News Network. We want to thank you all for continuing to spread this awesome mission about people being saved. You know, as I was reflecting this week, one of the things that came up is I was asking, what is salvation? What is salvation? And you know, God gave me salvation is consenting to be saved. That means you are consenting to be saved. I heard a story that I thought was awesome that kind of explains this. And the story is there was a lamb. This lamb was under a shepherd. There was many lambs under the shepherd. This one lamb went astray. When this lamb went astray, the shepherd missed the lamb and went out to find the lamb. He left the other lambs to go find this lamb. He went out, found the lamb, knew the lamb was lost, picked up the lamb, carried the lamb back, and tended and fed the lamb. My question is, what did the lamb do? Thing. That's right. The lamb absolutely did nothing. The lamb did not serve. The lamb did not do anything. It just consented to be saved, consented to be loved, consented to be carried, consented to be brought home. And that truly is what salvation is all about. With me this week, I have back my wonderful friend and brother in Christ, and that's Saint Albert from South Carolina. How you doing, brother?
Brother, it's good to be back again. I am so pleased that I'm in this show. It is so good, Rick, to be with you and to be a like spirit. And I know that you have an audience that is also a like spirit. There's been some things that have gone out this week that really were pretty awesome. As we were talking about this a little while ago, Rick, you know, today I went out, like always on Sunday, to have my lunch with my wife, and I met a brother in Christ, and what we talked about was incredible. I told him about the new church that we're opening, which is Saints Without Borders.
I talked
to him in reference to what we were all about helping people, and we talked about also about what a saint really is, and it's incredible how we both had the same spirit, and it was really good. It was really good. He said he was going to listen to us, and that it was something that he was praying for a long time. The Lord is so good, Rick. The Lord is so good. I mean, what are the chances of meeting somebody in the restaurant and telling you that he's been praying for this for a long time?
So if I understand you right, Albert, you're saying that you met him, you talked to him, and you let him know that we were opening up a church called Saints Without Walls, and he said, that's what he's been praying for?
That's correct, Rick. That's correct. And, Rick, there is a world of people out there, that they understand that there's something going on, and this is what they've been looking for a long time. I've been looking for it, Rick, and you've been looking for it. And I know that there's a lot of our audience that have been looking for this. We know that there's problems, and we sometimes cannot put our finger on it. until somebody, the Lord shows somebody, just like what happened to Luther, you know, the Lord shows Luther something, and soon enough, you know, we have the whole world understanding this. And this is what's going on in the world. You know, there's people going to church. Not that there's something wrong with going to church, but we have drifted. We have drifted from what the disciples has given us and from what Christ has given us. We have drifted really far. You know, when our attention is in buildings and stuff like that, and we neglect the saints, and we neglect the people around the church that we're supposed to bring into the church. And when we start bringing them in by buildings and by, you know, by things of the flesh, you know, we have a problem. We have a problem. When some of the pastors and some of the leaders of the church, they, when you see them and they're in the flesh too, and all you could hear from them and see from them is that they're living in lavishness. Again, not that lavishness is bad, but lavishness at the cost of the saints, that is bad. It wasn't, none of that was supposed to be that way. It wasn't supposed to be that way. And Rick, the Spirit is enlightening people. People are starting to understand, and people are starting to see. And a lot of times, a lot of people leave the churches, and they're being blamed. And one of the excuses is that nobody's perfect, and the churches are for the imperfect. That's a bunch of baloney, Rick. Churches are not for the imperfect. Churches are not for the sinners. Churches are for the perfect people. Because when you come to Christ, that's who you are. You are a perfected person. All right? So we have to come back again to the original church, what God intended to. And by the way, Rick, you know, I think that most everybody in the world has a feeling that there's something going on. I mean, most Christians, when you hear about, talk about, you know, prophecies and all that, they know that there's something going on in the world. You know, it's not gonna be long before our Lord Jesus Christ comes back again. You know, and we gotta help people. We gotta help people. You know, the gospel goes together with loving our brothers. And that's something that we have failed. We have failed in giving out the true gospel message, and we have failed in loving our brother. You know, I hate it whenever I go to a church, Rick, and somebody pats you on the back and says, "I love you with the love of the Lord," you know? And here you got a lot of people who are suffering and all that, and they give the same pat to them, you know? That's not what God said. What God said is love them with the love of the Lord means go ahead and help them out with your hands. Go ahead and meet their needs. If the Lord has blessed you and the Lord has blessed the church, meet that person's needs so he could glorify with the Lord just like we glorify with the Lord. And that's really the bottom line, you know. People are looking at us, Rick, from the outside and saying, "Is this the God that you're glorifying? You know, you guys can't even help each other." I mean, there's more people out there outside of the church helping people than the saints in the church helping people, than the church is helping people. And that has to stop. That has to stop, Rick. But I have here a couple of questions that I wanted to go through. And these are just some things that we have recalled from past studies, you know.
And, before we get into that,
yeah.
What I would like to do is, first of all, Albert well said, there's a lot going on in the world today that is truly affecting people in a very, very, I call it a spirit way, because what's happening is people know in the spirit there's something wrong with the politics. For example, in the U.S., that's why the non-politicians are the ones everybody's going for right now. Well, it's also the same way with church. A lot of people are going to church, of course, don't get me wrong, but a lot of people are leaving church because they know there's something wrong. They're feeling it inside, and they're not getting what they need at the church, and they don't feel that they're making a difference in their local community. They're not doing what they used to do. And I think there's a reason for that, though. I think, you know, as today we get, our show is You Think You Can Serve Christ? ? Well, we're going to go there because that's really what the church used to do, is they truly did serve Christ, but it was done in many different ways. If you think about it, schools started because of Christians, you know, and then all of a sudden, who comes in and takes over? The government. When the government comes in and takes over, every aspect that used to be started and, you know, hands-on experience from Christians around the world, then what happens is you kind of get a stagnation of Christianity. So what was the original church like? I mean, how many had these huge, you know, monster buildings, and they were putting all the money into the buildings? It just wasn't happening. So we're going to get into You Think You Can Serve Christ, the religious understanding of serving Christ. The common understanding regarding service is you get saved, you repent of your sin, you don't miss church attendance, and above all, serve the God who saved you. We've all done this. However, there is a better way. Years ago, when I first understood God's grace, I began to understand that God is the giver and we are the receivers. I had it backwards for most of my Christian life, and believe it or not, most Christians still have it backwards. My motivation is what God considers. We can serve out of duty, out of what will I get back, or how does it align with abiding in the vine, even unto entering our rest. The book of Hebrews tells us to labor at one thing, and that is entering his rest. So when we dive into this and we kind of get into this today, you were talking a little bit off air about how getting into the money part of it. We are the receivers, not the givers. So, you know, let's go there for a minute and tell our audience how the original church did the money thing, because it's different than how our church is doing the money thing today. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, you're completely right, my brother. You see, in the original church, if you looked in the book of Acts, okay, everything that came into the church was laid down at the disciples' feet and given to the people in the church, to the saints in the church, as they had need. And that is not occurring today. And like we talked before, that also goes back into the old covenant too, you know. And the church, and the old church, they also laid provisions for people who were involved in the church, for them to get, you know, to be able to live, to have a salary or whatever they needed to live. But it was all done so they could live, not to live outside of a lavishness that the people in the churches did not have. You know, I'm not talking here now that you have a job outside of the church and that you're making money and you're doing well, and now, you know, everybody has to be equal in the church as you are. That's not what we're talking about here. What we're talking about here is the money coming into the church. The money coming into the church went to help the people in need of the church. You know, and when the people, or the saints, better yet, let's call them, because that's who they are, when the saints in the church are helped, then they could go out and bring the ministry of salvation and also the ministry of hope and help to the communities. How can you expect a person in a church that is suffering because he doesn't have the money for whatever, for food or for clothing or for whatever it is that that person has, for whatever circumstance he's in the position, how can you expect that person to be able to go to that community and help the community and bring the grace of God to the community? You can't. He won't be able to.
So the Christian walks into this church. The church says, give money. Christian gives money. Christian gives as much as they can based upon what they can give. And it's everything they've got. Then all of a sudden, then the church says, now go out to your community and give to the community. with no money you have left over because you've given it to the church. I'm not saying don't give to your church, don't tithe to your church. What we are saying is once the money is brought into the storehouse, how is the storehouse using those resources? Are they putting them back into the people? Which God says, you are the building, not the bricks, the mortar, none of that. You are the building. So is that what you're saying? It's happening out there right now, Albert?
Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying, my brother Rick. And like I said last week, I had a drawing, and just for I'm going to repeat it again, just so people that didn't hear last week. And you know, if you could close your eyes and imagine a church full of sheep or lambs, okay? And on the left hand side, you see them all sitting down in the pupils, and on the left hand side, you see them standing up and going up to the altar. And a pastor in the altar turning them over and taking all their change out of their pockets and saying, this is for the building fund, right? And then releasing that sheep, and then that sheep walking out, and then the rest of the leaders in the church telling that sheep, okay, now you got to help the community, and you got to help the people in need of the churches. And that sheep has her pockets out with nothing in them. And that's what's occurring in the churches. I called it fleecing the sheep, because that's what's occurring. They're fleecing the sheep. They're stealing from the sheep. When we receive money in the church, that money could be used for living expenses of the pastors. It could be used for that. But the majority of the money should have been going to the sheep. I mean, it is so funny and you will hear this in a lot of churches, Rick. You will hear whenever they need money for the building, you will hear them that the whole church has to get together and we have to collect this money for the building. This is a congressional thing and everybody has to be involved in this, right? But whenever it comes time to help a sheep in the church or to help the community, what they say is that you're on your own. When you come out of this church, be a good Christian, and whenever you could help somebody, go ahead and help that person, you know? But you're basically on your own.
Now, I want to give you a study that was done. There was a gentleman in 1997. The University of Pennsylvania, Ram Kanan, has long been searching for a specific answer to the question that is a church's tax-exempt status, does it outweigh the economic value it adds to its community? So the university got together and did this study, and it detailed out in detail 12 different historic Philadelphia congregations, including First Baptist Church, whose annual value to the local economy. And then what happens is Kanan's team places conservatively $1,090,032, nearly 10 times its annual budget, some of the items that contribute, and he lays them out. I think what happens is we don't realize the value of the money brought back into the community from the church. But the problem is the church isn't the building. The church was the people giving back in the church. But we've got to use the old model and not rob people like you've been talking about, Albert, into where, you know, because there's a lot of churches that do give back, okay? But there's a lot that don't.
Yeah.
I think the people feel the frustration because either A, they're not informed enough on how much the church is involved in giving back to the community, but I think the church should be very open about the money that it does give back and detail it out for the entire congregation. Because if you don't, whether the truth exists or not of the church giving, the perception is there. And what happens is perception is reality. So we on the radio station, and as we do our ministries, we feel what people, you know, are saying to where they're concerned about what's going on with the dollars inside churches and these lavish buildings and everything that, that are built. And, you know, God's people need to be blessed. God's people need to be blessed because he even talks about how living life and living life abundantly, and that's blessing from God. I totally believe that. But our mission here at God News Network and our new church that we're building is Saints Without Walls, is we want to put as much as possible back into the people. That's really where we're going with this. And I agree with you, Albert. I mean, there's a lot of people who aren't, a lot of churches who aren't doing that. But it's really interesting how the studies show how vital local churches are and what it does mean to the local economy. But are the money being put in the right place? You know, where are they putting it? You know, they even got on here categories like reduced crime rate, volunteer hours, getting people off drugs, how much money was spent on this one church, crime prevention and reentry, divorces prevented, how much money was spent, building enhancements and capital gains, our campaigns, trees, helping people gain employment. I was surprised how much money was spent there. It was a lot, $725,000 just from one church. Suicide prevention, $58,000. Garden and lawn and cemetery, $146. And then K through 12 school, $2,489,000, which is students.
Wow.
And a church budget of only $520,000 a year.
You see, that's a good church, and that's what we're supposed to be doing. You know, there's a lot of churches that are doing more than what they can. And
yes.
But unfortunately, there's a lot of churches which are not. And, you know, we have, as you know, Rick, I live in the Carolinas. And we have here, unfortunately, we have here places that help people, you know, of saints that have gone out and done for themselves something to help people, you know, whether it be people that have criminal behaviors or drug addictions or kids that are... their parents are in jail or something like that, and they're helping them out by giving them a home and stuff like that. But a lot of times, a lot of these places, Rick, they close down because they don't have the funding. It's amazing. They don't have the funding. And to me, it is real sad because, listen, Rick, I live in what is called the Bible Belt, okay? I could, with one stone, I could hit six churches and within a block radius, okay? And we're spending, Rick, so much money into buildings and so much money into all this religiousness that we have forgotten a lot of times in a lot of churches what this money was supposed to be used for. If just where I live, if the churches here will really spend money on the people, this place will be paradise. South Carolina will be paradise, I'm telling you, because there's five churches in every corner. There won't be nobody here in need. And when those people out of the churches see that, see what's going on in the churches, they want to see why it is that those people are so gracious and why it is that those people are so loving. And when they come and see that, they're supposed to be able to see the reason, and that is that we're working with the love of God. And they will be, they will,
Let's take that and talking about the love of God and getting into how do we, as the people, as the building, how do we serve? How do we serve Jesus? So we think we can serve Jesus. Let's ask a few questions. I love how Pastor Bob put this. Pastor Bob wrote a nice little article on this, and he goes into serving Jesus by allowing Jesus to serve you, which is in right alignment with how we feel here at God News Network. He says, riddle me this. So when does the master become the servant, and when is a servant the one that is served? Can a servant become the one that is served without being the master? John 13:7 says, Jesus answered and said unto him, and now this is when they're having supper. He gets done at the Lord's Supper. And Jesus gets up and he girdles himself with a towel, and he walks over and he puts a basin of water down and he starts to wash the disciples' feet. And Jesus answered unto Peter, because Peter says, why are you washing my feet? Are you washing my feet? Jesus answered and said to him, what I am doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this. And here's the revelation and understanding regarding serving Jesus. A servant is not the one who serves Jesus. A servant is one whom Jesus can serve through others. For example, I like to say one of the best analogies I've heard is you're like a piece of fiber laying in the ground, a piece of glass just laying in the ground. Albert, how much value does the glass have if it's just laying in the ground?
Well, it has no value.
It has no value because there's nothing on either end of the fiber that's connected. Now, you take one end of the fiber and it's connected to God, and the other end of the fiber, it's connected to that man you met in a restaurant. Okay? And you are the fiber. What are you actually doing?
I'm just being a vessel is using to do whatever he needs to be done, whatever needs to be done.
How much effort is the fiber producing?
Nothing at all. There's no effort in the fiber. Yeah.
There's no effort in the fiber, and you are the fiber, so you are the vessel, just like you said. So God is transmitting, the other person is receiving. So you're laying in the ground, you're just doing what you do by resting, and let God transmit, and let this person receive. I see so often in ministry to where people are working really hard to make sure that Joe seems to understand that you shouldn't have tattoos. That Joe needs to understand you can't be saying those words. That Joe needs to understand he's going to have to stop sinning. Time out. It's not us and our responsibility to do any of that. That's the Holy Spirit's responsibility. It's his responsibility to do that, not us. Our job is to be the vessel to open our mouth when God is inside telling us to say something. As you know, coming out of religion and into the understanding of God's grace kills a lot of sacred cows, Bob says. And this is one of them because too many religious people want to serve. I've got to serve. I've got to serve. I've got to serve. So the religious understanding that I read earlier now starts to make sense. If you go to Hebrews 10:11, that's Hebrews chapter 4, verses 10 and 11, it says, he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works, as God did from his. Let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest. There may be a lot of people around you that are not doing what you know they should be doing. Right, Albert?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. We have mm-hmm. we see it all the time in ministry. How many people mm-hmm. are doing what they should be doing? Mm. You know what the good news is? It's okay. That's between them and God. They got to answer that. So now the responsibility comes back on to whom?
It's to God.
Yeah, it's on him. And what is our concern now? Is our concern with all these people not doing what they should do? Or is it more, maybe I need to focus on resting in
nice.
Him?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So not only do we
yeah.
enter the Father's rest, we must also cease, it says, from whose works?
From our works.
From our works. Now, would we call it rest when we're concerned with everybody else and what they're doing or not doing, or would we call it works?
Mm. Mm.
Interesting.
It's works. Yeah.
It's works. Yeah. It's not rest.
Yes.
With this
yeah.
in mind, isn't service a form of work if we're trying either to help people do or help people not do? Either way, it's a form of work. If the truth be known, it is Jesus who wants to serve. He does not need our service. Paul alluded to this in Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. Not my faith. So let's break that down in Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ. Now, wait a minute. Time out. Physically, Albert, have we been crucified with Christ physically?
No, it was spiritually.
It was spiritually. So mm-hmm. if I was crucified with Christ, how much effort did I put into this by being crucified with Christ?
No effort at all.
None. I didn't do any of it. It is no longer I who live, but Christ mm-hmm. lives in me. How much effort do I have by allowing Christ to live in me?
None. No
and
effort.
The life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. So whose faith?
His faith.
It's
thank
not
God.
Even my faith. So who loved me and he gave himself for me? So here's the question. If you no longer live, who is doing the serving?
It's Christ. You know, and it's amazing that he says, you know, my Father is always working, and so shall I always be working too.
Yeah, so we don't have to. He mm-hmm. serves, so we're imputed rest, even though he deserves the rest. Because of our flesh, we feel we have to get involved. And we have to add to the service of Christ. It's kind of like salvation. Good luck adding anything to what Christ did. Good luck adding anything to what he's currently doing. Paul saw this understanding. What is better, serving Jesus or allowing Jesus to serve through us? The righteous live by faith. Yeah, the righteous live by faith, not service. But unfortunately, the religious want to serve. They want to serve. They want to serve. They want to serve. They want to serve. While walking by his faith will produce works of service. Service without faith is a dead work. I'm sure you've heard it said, faith without works is dead. And here's what God tells me about this. Now, this isn't what Bob writes. This is what Rick heard from God. That old saying in James where it says, faith without works is dead, is because the works is whose works?
Oh, my brother, that is good. It's his work.
It's his works. It is not our works. So faith without works is dead because A, it's his faith. B, it's his works. So absolutely faith without works is dead because the work is finished. Well, works without faith is just as dead. So many pastors have tried to get you on that little quandary of saying, well, wait a minute, it can't be just faith alone, because faith without works is dead. Well, of course, whose faith was it, mine or his? It was his. Whose works was it? Was it mine or was it his? It was his. So absolutely, if I don't agree with faith without works is dead, I'm saying I don't agree with what Jesus did. And I absolutely agree. But it has nothing to do with my faith, has nothing to do with your works, Albert. It is his from beginning to end. And even he said at the cross, it is finished.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, brother.
The light bulb just went off for all these legalist pastors around listening to this show right now, and they're having a sacred cow.
That's why, my brother Rick, that's why it says in the Bible that the leaders in the church are not supposed to be mastering over their people. What they're supposed to be doing is that they're supposed to be giving the people, whenever the person gets an insight of what the Holy Spirit wants him to do, they're supposed to supply that person with the needs of what he needs so he could accomplish the work of the Holy Spirit that's working in him. You see, that's the work of a leader in the church, really. The work of a leader in the church is to provide for the saints whatever they need in order for the work of the Spirit in them to be worked out.
The good news is, Albert, we can take that even a step further, because we're not even reliant upon the leaders of the church anymore. Because we have direct access to Christ without going through a leader of a church. Because the curtain has been torn from top to bottom. There is no more high priest in any building that needs to be gone through. Matthew 20:28 says it very clearly, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served. Wait a minute, time out. That goes against religion. Everybody wants to serve Christ. But he says, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, to give his life as a ransom.
You know, Rick, that is so powerful. You know, that reminds me of now, you know, we're having Christmas pretty close. Christmas is right around the corner.
Yes.
Have you ever had this, Rick, that you have some member in your family or a friend that has everything? And what goes in your mind is, what can I give this person? He has everything. And if you were to talk to that person, he would say, don't give me nothing because I got everything. You see, what I want is you to come over here and have fellowship with me.
Amen.
I mean, I don't know about you, Rick, but have you had that instance that you've had a personal friend or a family that here's his birthday or here comes Christmas and you go, man, should I give this person a gift? What can I give him? This guy has everything. What is it that he needs, you know?
Very well said.
And in true reality, you do them sometimes even favors by not giving them nothing, just giving them your love and your fellowship with them, because what you're going to be giving them is something that they got. They might open up the door of a garage and they might have 15,000 of the items that you have given them because they got.
and think about that from Jesus' perspective. Now think about it. It is Jesus is God in the flesh, right? So God created what?
He created us.
What did he not create? He created everything.
Oh, yeah. He created everything.
So here's God who creates everything.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing he hasn't created and nothing he doesn't own.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to offer up something for him?
And he created, it's incredible, Rick, and he created everything out of abundance. You know one thing that I always marvel at, Rick, you know, You know, we could. All he had to do for humans is create a banana tree, and with a banana tree, we will have all the protein, all the nutrition that we will ever need. Okay, but he's so lavish. He went overboard with what he created. And by the way, all this was created for us. It wasn't created for him. It was created for us as a gift for us. But, you know, and I don't know about your town, Rick, but in my town, there's probably 1,000 restaurants here. And every time I go to a different restaurant, the meal is completely different. And I enjoy that meal, and I go, my God, Lord, you have outdone yourself in this meal. Then I go to another restaurant, and I got to say it again. I go, Lord, but this is amazing, you know. And you just got to go from place to place, and you eat one fruit, and then you eat another fruit, and you go, my God, Lord, but all this just for me? All this gifts, you know? And it is amazing. It is amazing because everything that has been created, it was created for our pleasure. It was us, the reason that everything was created.
And Jesus has freely given us all things. You're right. Everything. It's awesome. In Romans 8:32, he says, he who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? He has given us all things. For what? Works of service. So how can we serve if we've never been served by Jesus? We all do our part to some extent or another. We do want to do our best most of the time, right? But is it truly the best? Remember, the good always gets in the way of the best. Today, I believe it is our resting that will allow Jesus to truly serve us. Jesus is looking for those in the body of Christ that will allow him to serve them. It is in the receiving that the power of the cross is realized, not the other way around. With this in mind, I need to learn how to allow Jesus to serve me. John 6:35 says, and Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never hunger. He who believes in me shall never thirst. Question. When do we stop coming to Jesus for more bread or more living water? Are we not to pray for our daily bread? Oh, this is a revelation for many Christians who have been living under legalese. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And that is Christ. He said, I am the bread of life. Give us this day our daily bread, not food. He is our food. It appears to me that Jesus is still serving. How many times have you heard someone say it is more blessed to give than to receive? Well, it's harder to receive than it is to give. Because why? Most people think they have to be a part or it's not valuable. There's no value in it. I've got to do something. Jesus is still looking for those he can serve. Now as you receive bread, a living word from the Master, this is the bread that you serve to one another. We can only give away what we have been given. This is truly the service. How can you give away information that you don't know? How can you give away things that you have no understanding of? When you learn to receive, you will automatically give. When you're excited about a new movie, do you keep quiet? No, you share. When you really truly learn that Jesus is real, that he really saves you by just you consenting to be saved, because he already did the work, and you really get that from your head into your heart, guess what automatically flows? Because it isn't you flowing, It's him flowing through you like the piece of fiber laying in the ground. Allow me to set the stage for John 13, 1 through 17. Before you tell me that this chapter is giving us an example that we should all wash with water each other's feet as acts of service, please consider the spiritual understanding of this. Just like earlier it said, I've died with Christ. That wasn't physical, it was spiritual. Christ spoke in spiritual most of the time, almost all of the time. And he didn't understand why they couldn't get it. Right? So here we go. John 13. Now, before the feast of Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Verse 2, and supper being ended, the devil, having already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray Jesus, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel, which he was girded. Then he came to Simon Peter, and Peter said to him, Lord, are you washing my feet? Jesus answered and said to him, what I am doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this. Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet! Exclamation point. Jesus answered, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. Not in me, with me. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Now, question, Albert, was Peter getting this in the spirit, or is he in the flesh?
He's in the complete flesh.
He don't get it yet, right? So in verse 10, Jesus said to him, he who is bathed only needs to wash his feet. Now, the word bathed is in the same sentence as wash his feet. Most people would take that as the same word. That is not the same word. They're two separate words. The first word has complete consuming bathing, like in the blood of Christ, I am cleansed through and unto salvation. The second one was to get the dirt off. For example, a piece of metal is turned into a solid piece of gold. Now, how valuable is that gold? It's extremely valuable, wouldn't you say, Albert?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now that gold is now running into mud. Has it changed the value of the gold?
Still valuable.
Right.
Still gold.
But it's got mud on it. So now, Jesus is saying, you are saved, but I still need to wash your feet. This is really an incredibly good understanding. But before I tell it to you, I'm going to continue. But it is completely clean. So he says again, verse 10, Jesus said to him, he who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. Even though you're dirty, you're still completely clean, and you are clean, but not all of you. He's talking about Judas, who's about to betray him. For he knew that he who would betray him. Therefore, he said, you are not all clean. Verse 12. So, when he had washed their feet, he had taken his garments, sat down again, and he said to them, do you know what I've done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, for I am so. If I, then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent, in other words, Jesus, greater than the one who sent him, God. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered it, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. Jesus was not telling Peter he would not have any part in him. No, he said, you will not have a part with me. You will not flow with me in service to the lost, the children, and the sons of God. In short, you will not allow me to serve you. Ooh, Note, the word is with, which means you will not flow with me in ministry. If the word had been of me, this would mean salvation. So now let's consider your riddle. Riddle me this. So when does the master also become the servant? And when is the servant the one that is served? And can a servant become the one that is served without being the master? First question. So when does the master also become the servant? Answer. The master, Jesus, is considered the servant king. The Prince of Peace fed 5,000. The servant king went around doing good and healing all that were sick. Second question, when is the servant the one that is served? Answer, we are served. When we are given our daily bread, we are served. When we discover a long sought after meaning of a particular Bible verse, we are served. We are served when another tells us, thank you so much, I really saw Jesus. We are served when we tell another, all your sins are forgiven. However, if you do not believe all your sin has been forgiven, then you cannot give it away. How can you give away the beautiful experience of living water if you have not received the servant Jesus Christ? Remember, Jesus came not to be served, but to serve. John 7:38, he who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Living water is our service to others. Jesus is our living water. Now here's the third question. Can a servant become the one that is served without being the master? Yes. Consider all the works of God. Were they not for mankind? What does God need from us? Do not all of our children receive from us most of what we pour into their lives? Will they not give away what they have received from the love of their earthly father? When we begin to see Jesus in the light of receiving his love, we slowly begin to share that love in a way that never thought possible. Just as I am serving you as you read this. This is what Jesus gives us. In conclusion, the more we allow Jesus to serve us, the more effective we will be in the Master's hand for service.
Well said, my brother. Well said.
Thank you, Pastor Bob Coker, and thank you, Jesus Christ, because he does all the serving. And you know, how many people have you ran into about that James verse, that faith without works is dead?
Oh, a lot of people. Just about half of the church or more.
Have you ever heard it explained that way that I just explained it on the radio?
No.
I never either, and God gave that to me, and I'm going, oh my, it lines up with the rest of the Bible, because whose faith is it? It's not mine. Whose works is it? It's his, because he's the one doing the serving. So faith without works is dead. But it's just a different meaning than the religious mean it.
Yeah. It's my prayer, and I'm sure that it's your prayer, and there's probably a lot of people out there that it's their prayer, and what it is that that we start letting God work through us, you know, that we start loving people through God's love, that God's love flow through us. You know, it's not a matter of we owe God, you know, that's the flesh. Whenever we start saying in church that we do things because we owe him, that's not what God wants us to think, you know, and it will never work with the spiritual world in that way. You know, I hear the reasons, let's just talk about giving, the reasons why a lot of churches say that we should give, and you could see immediately that they're not talking spiritually, they're talking in the flesh, you know, because we owe him something, you know, or you know, when Christ died on the cross, he died freely. When he gave us everything, he gave us everything freely. And so that's what he wants to do. He wants to do everything freely through us. And if we work, if we use our works, he's not flowing through us freely. Everything has to be freely with God. Nothing that involves work will ever be compatible with the gospel and with God. And it's just, and it's not, don't think of this as a mystery just in us. It was the same thing with God. With Jesus Christ, God the Father flew through him. And he said it himself. He says that the works that I do are not mine. And I hear my Father do his work, and I do his work. In other words, what he's saying is that his Father's work was flowing through him. And that's what it should be with us. Yep.
I agree, brother. Well said. You know, it's easy to get caught up into things that really don't matter, you know. We in life are so busy. We've got our daily lives, and we have to survive in this world. And we get our minds pulled into anxiety, into chaos, into works of the flesh, and we don't just let go. Let God work through us. And realize that, like you said, Albert, we are here to love and minister to those around us, but we don't do it. That's the beauty. We really aren't doing anything except laying there and let him do it. So when God puts it on your heart to go touch a person and pray, do it. If God puts it on your heart to hand someone $20, do it. If God puts it on your heart to feed someone, do it. Because there's innocents out there that don't have anybody looking out for them. And we are there to be conduits and listen to our Father. And our Father will guide us. He will tell us. He will instruct you. Don't expect perfection. Don't expect you to not make mistakes, because you're in the flesh. You have an unfair advantage due to the sin that occurred in the Garden of Eden. Because of that sin, we have now flesh that will decay. Our brain decays. Our body decays. Our tongues don't work right sometimes. It's okay. We are to love and exalt and lift each other up in Christ, through Christ, and allow Christ to work through us. That's done by letting go. And that is so hard for humans, because we've been performance-based from the time we were born. Look, my child walked before yours. Look, my child got into school a year earlier than yours. Look, my child's better at baseball than yours. Look, are you kidding me? That's low brain mentality. I'm sorry, but it is. It is, look at Jesus. Look at Jesus. Look at Jesus. That's the love. That's the love. And I always like to close the show, Albert, by giving people an opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And I would like to do that right now. I would like to reach out to all of you out there who have never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. I'm asking that you just bow your head, close your eyes, pay attention to the Father's voice as he calls you, as he reaches out to you. You can hear him saying, come home, come home. I want you home with me. I'm going to pick you up. I'm going to carry you back to home. And I'm asking that you consent to be saved. Accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Repeat after me. Lord, I accept you as my Lord and Savior. I accept, Father, your Son, who died on the cross for me, was buried and resurrected. And I receive salvation. I receive the abundant life. I receive all the blessings that are meant for me by allowing and consenting to be saved and consenting to be loved. And I accept this in the name of Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And
thank
now,
you, Lord.
Albert, we need to get this Saints Without Walls thing up, because people are needing, and there's people at home that can't get out. And the more and more as the baby boomers decide they can't get out because of immobility, they can still go to church. Thank you for tuning in to God News Network. Tell your friends, GodNewsNetwork.com. GodNewsNetwork.com every Sunday at 8 p.m. Be blessed. and have a beautiful evening.